We interrupt this record to bring you a special bulletin. The reports of a flying saucer hovering over the city have been confirmed.
Did you really go out with an alien? Uh-huh. What was it like? Real different.
Becoming Human, a Mork and Mindy podcast. Hey everybody, this is Paula Schaffner with episode 13, Mork and the Immigrant. This first aired on January 11th, 1979. The IMDb synopsis is, Mork meets Sergey, a Russian immigrant, and invites him to live with them. After Sergey refers to himself as an alien, Mork becomes convinced that he himself has to register with the government as an alien. This was directed by Howard Storm, his 7th of 59 Mork and Mindy episodes. It was written by David O'Malley, his first of two scripts, and it's April Kelly's 5th. We start with the nighttime exterior of the house.
Welcome, friends, to the Temple of Suds. If you're ready now, throw down your forks and come forward and have your soul cleansed in the joy to come. I've got some good news and some bad news. First, the bad news, this sucker's hot. But now the good news, tonight we'll be having a jacuzzi.
Mindy comes home and she's so angry that she flings her coat onto the table. Mork asks why she's mad at her coat. She says her watch stopped, so she got a ticket. He says on Ork, when your watch stops, they just give you a warning and they take away Mickey's hands. So apparently it's a Mickey Mouse watch. Or maybe there is an Ork named Mickey who appears on their watches. Mindy parked in a no parking after six zone and she got a $15 ticket. I need to mention, she actually refers to her Jeep, which is the first mention of the Jeep in the episodes, not counting the credits, since the pilot. So she did at some point in the last several months get the Jeep back, and she's driving it around. And this might have something to do with the fact that in the previous episode, she's going to night school. That might be why she's parking after six. She doesn't want to pay the ticket, so Mork tells her she doesn't have to, and he's with her, and he tells her, right on, Mama, and he has his fist in the air like this is some sort of 60s protest. She says she has to. It's the law. Mork asks her a bunch of questions, and she explains that the town council passed this law, and they were elected by the people of Boulder, which includes Mindy herself, so Mork says that she voted to give herself a ticket. Mindy says that in a democracy, everybody votes and the majority wins. So Mork says that he votes that they adopt Dolly Parton, so that's at least the second Dolly Parton reference on the series. He's surprised that he doesn't win, and she says that with two people, you can never have a winner. He says democracy will never replace bobbing for French fries. Mindy says that she's not an authority, so Mork should go out and talk to other people and get their opinions. She tells him that you need at least three people to vote so that you can have someone to break the tie. He's surprised that you can only vote once. He says on Ork, if someone wants to be president, everyone else says, sure, go ahead, it's cool, which is a pretty casual way to hold an election. The next scene is at the music store, and Fred and Cora are organizing the records again. Mork has just finished an observation of the migration of the North American wino, who did not move that far. Mork says he can take Mindy home now, which seemed odd to me, because it's not, he's going to be driving the Jeep, but from what I recall from previous episodes, the house is walking distance from the music store. Mindy can't go with him because Susan Taylor has invited Mindy to Susan's shop. There's going to be a makeup demonstration and she wants Mindy to be the model. And so this means that Susan Taylor owns some sort of fashion shop, I guess, or maybe a cosmetics store. And also after Christmas, she and Mindy are at least on good enough terms that Mindy is willing to model for her.
Oh, like the ones in Playboy.
Hi, my name is Candy. My hobbies are body surfing and neutron physics, and I hope to one day know the entire Los Angeles Rams.
Mindy says this is different because she's only working from the chin up. She's going to get a new face, and so Cora asks for Mindy's old face. And when Mindy leaves, Mork says ciao, so he apparently adopted that from Susan on the previous episode. Mork counts the remaining people, and it's three, so now they can play democracy. He says everybody's doing it, and then he does a little do the vote dance. Fred says there's nothing to vote about, so Mork says they can vote to adjourn, and you just say ear. Fred corrects this to I, so then Mork says that's two, they have a majority, and they win, and so they can pack it in. Fred says he doesn't want to play, so Mork calls him a Republican. Cora says she has something fun for Mork to do. He can file the classical albums. So he files them all under A for albums. He says that was easy, but not fun. Meanwhile, a man in a dark hat and a dark sort of fisherman's jacket has come in. He's carrying an instrument case, and Fred tells him that they don't fix cellos. They just sell them, because this is a music store. The man, who has an accent, says that Fred can keep the cello. Fred says that he knows where the man can get the cello fixed, but the man says that there's nothing wrong with it. Fred nonetheless gives him a card for the repair shop. The man is about to leave, but then he and Mork start interacting. And when Mork says that the man speaks lousy, the man says he's not from here around. He describes himself as an alien, so Mork says, "Leaping lizard, so am I." This man is Sergei from Slavisgrad. Mork asks if this is near Alpha Centauri, so that's at least the second Alpha Centauri reference. Sergei asks if Ork is near Minsk. Mork says Sergei has him by the shorts, unless Minsk is the one with eight moons. It turns out that Sergei has no place to live, so he's been sleeping in the park, but that's not good for his cello. Mork relates to this and asks if Sergei has to make reports on his observations. Sergei says he's not a spy, he's a magician and a student. He plays in the sympathy. He won't get his first paycheck for another couple weeks. Mork thinks Sergei is lucky because Mork has to report back to a fat dude named Orson, and that's who made him come here. Sergei says no one made Sergei Khrushchev come here. He wanted to be part of a democracy because he's been studying democracy. Mork tells him that he and Mindy are forming a democracy. Sergei says, "Leaping lizards, no faking?" Mork invites Sergei to live with him and Mindy. He says that Mindy is a girl that he lives with, and neither of them is married. Sergei Khrushchev obviously takes his last name from the Russian leader. He is played by Tim Thomerson, who oddly enough was on the 8 episodes of Quark, where he played a transgender character named Jean, G-E-N-E, / Jean, J-E-A-N. And that series also featured Conrad Janis as a character named Palindrome. It aired from 77 to 78, and I saw it at the time. And I think I vaguely recognized Conrad Janis when he showed up on Mork and Mindy. I think it did pretty badly in the ratings. It was not a successful use of sci-fi and comedy together. I do like that Conrad Janis and Tim Thomerson had that little moment of conversation in this scene. Oddly enough, Fred is still in the room. Cora has gone into the practice room. It seems strange that Fred doesn't catch any of this conversation and object to Mork inviting people to move in with Fred's daughter when Fred is still getting used to Mork. We get another nighttime exterior of the house, and Mork leads Sergei into the apartment. Sergei says, "Holy moly, such beautiful apartment." He thinks that Mork must be making big bucks, and he wonders if Mork is an American rock star. He quickly asks if Mork has pairs of Levi's and if he knows the Beach Boys and Chuck Berry. And then he does a quick snippet of long distance information with a Russian dance. Mindy comes home and Mork makes introductions, and he keeps going back and forth with their names, gradually shortening them until it's one letter each. Sergei greets her with Nanu Nanu, so she sees that he's been spending time with Mork. He says that Mork has been sharing things about the customs, then he demonstrates face-sitting. Mindy asks what they think of her new face, and Sergei says, "This is a great country. If you don't like your face, you can get a new one." Mork says, "It's the same face, just a new paint job." Mindy sarcastically says she knew it'd knock his socks off. Sergei says he's a student and a cello player. Mork says that Sergei is going to be part of their democracy. Mindy says that Sergei will love living in this country. Mork explains that he means their democracy, as in his and Mindy's. He's going to be their third so that they can vote. He's going to live with them. Mindy wants to talk to Mork, so Mork calls a vote on it. He and Sergei vote against it. Mork and Mindy talk through gritted teeth, and she insists. Sergei asks where the laboratory is, as in a restroom. Mindy points towards her bedroom door. So he opens the door and he sees the bed and says, "This is a restroom where you can really rest. America really is out of state." Now that they're alone, Mindy tells Mork that he can't just invite people to come live here. He suggests they vote on it. She says she pays the rent and he can't stay. He says, "I see. The one with the money controls the votes." He tells her that Sergey has been sleeping outside on a bench and he's got a violin with a gland condition. Mork says he doesn't think democracy is working out too well. So he begs for a dictatorship, and he says he'll be the tyrant and she'll be the peon. And he's like an excited little kid. Sergey returns in a short nightshirt. He again says that this is a wonderful country because in Russia he has to sleep with his 11 brothers, but it'll be only 3 people in this bed. Mindy looks understandably irritated, and Mork continues to look clueless. We get another exterior of the house, and this time there's a lot of snow, including covering an orange car. And I don't know if that car belongs to Sergey. I don't think so, because it seems like he would have been sleeping in the car rather than on the bench. Mork is hanging upside down in the wardrobe, and he's wearing a blue union suit and a white football helmet. I was surprised he wasn't wearing the usual nightshirt, but maybe they were worried it was going to ride up, or rather hang down. He takes off his helmet, and he does a quick lotus position standing up. He says, "Om Mani Padme Hum," which the captioning says is Orkin, but actually it is a saying that means the jewel is in the lotus. Mindy comes in, and he tells her that he slept in the guest room so that Sergey could have the penthouse. She wants to talk to him about Sergey. To the tune of the Toyota jingle, he says, "You asked for it, you got it, I'm listening." She says Sergey seems like a nice guy, but you can't invite people to live here. Mork says that Mindy told him to get out and ask people questions. She says she didn't mean questions like, "Do you want to come home and live with me?" Mork says that she could invite a friend, but then they'd have 4, and democracy only works with odd numbers. Mindy says that Sergey is a stranger. Mork says that he was a stranger, and she asked him to live with her. She says that he's even stranger now. Mindy says Mork was a special case because he really needed help. Mork says that Sergey needs help. Mindy says Mork can help him by finding an apartment and making him feel like he belongs. Mork says this would be sort of an extraterrestrial welcome wagon. She says she'll take money out of her savings account and loan it to Sergey. Mork calls her a real werble, and I think we had werble on a previous episode, but it wasn't a compliment. But I don't remember details on that. Mindy says she'll be at the music store if he needs her. Mork says he and Sergey are like 2 fish out of water. Mork is pleased that Sergey likes cowboy movies too. Sergey says where he comes from, they love all American movies. He's seen Citizen Kane, When the Wind is Leaving, and In Front of On the Water. His favorite is The Lonesome Ranger.
Look, Kimosabe, something strange, buckboard on its back. Hey, Tonto, you're right. 500 people tied up with dental floss.
Help me, Lone Ranger. Where'd you get that ugly engine?
Why are they not gagged up, Meshuggah Nuts?
Behind you! Varmints, look!
I'm not those shy and those stinking varmints. On the boys, amigos! On the left! And on the left!
And on the left! Well, that shows them, Tonto. Onward! Where's that masked man? He stole my teeth. I need them for the bullets. Hello, Silver! Oh, big fella, there. Sorry about that, big fella.
Sergey says Mork should be a TV star. Mork says that would be too much pressure and he'd have to get up too early, which I assume was a little joke on Robin Williams. Sergey says everything is going wonderfully. He has a new friend and a place to live. Mork tells him that Mindy said there's only room for 2 people here and Sergey has to find a place of his own. Sergey is surprised that he can live on his own if he wants to. Where he comes from, no one lives alone. Sharing a room with 60 people is like solitary confinement. Mork says there must be a long line for a shower, and the word shower makes Sergei think about all his new experiences, like disco dancing, dirt bikes, burritos, and registering as an alien. Mork has never heard of this, and Sergei explains that all aliens must register by January. I looked this up, and in 1977, there was a new, more counterfeit-resistant version of the green card, and it was called Form I-551. And it was also known as a resident alien card. So I'm not sure what the January thing means, but maybe if you arrived in a calendar year, you had to register by the following January. And also, does this mean it's still December? So maybe this is happening sometime between Christmas and the New Year. Mork is surprised there are so many aliens. Sergei says there are thousands, millions. Mork says, well, that it must not be a big deal. And Sergei says it's a big deal if you don't register. It's a law that you have to. Mork is surprised that Mindy didn't tell him about this, so Sergei asks if she's an alien, and Mork says no, she's Caucasian, which felt kind of racist, but I don't think it was supposed to be. Mork says that he's not supposed to get in trouble. Orson will be really TO'd, as in ticked off. Sergei says he saw two men picked up by the authorities. They were aliens without proper identification. He says that Mork will need to go to the Immigration Bureau, and Mork imitates his accent on that. Mork says he'll have to write Mindy a note. Sergei asks if Mork knows where it is, and Mork says that he can't because he hasn't written it yet, as in the note, and then they both do the bark laugh. Then we get an exterior of the Boulder County Justice Center, which might have been where Mork had his sanity hearing, but in any case, in this shot, there's a lot of snow. We see Mork and Sergei come in, and Mork is surprised that all of these people are aliens. He asks a woman if she's from Romney 5. I don't know if that's a reference to George Romney, the Republican governor who ran for president in 1968 and was the father of Mitt Romney. In any case, this woman is not from Romney 5 because she doesn't have a second nose on her hand. Mork tells the clerk that he's here to register as an alien, so the clerk gives him a form. Mork tells Sergei that the clerk wasn't even fazed when Mork told him he was an alien. Sergei says the clerk sees hundreds of aliens a week. Mork says, wait till Orson hears about this. Mork looks at a wanted poster and says that those are the 10 most popular people. They look like nimnolls. Sergei says they're actually criminals. And Mork says, criminals, nimnolls, they don't look too swift to him. He notices that the pen is on a leash and jokes that it must have written a bad check. They're both filling out their forms, and Mork seems to be having fun with his, going question by question, putting Mork and Ork for name and land of origin. For education, he puts PS1006, using that old-fashioned way of referring to schools. PS stands for public school. And also, there must have been a lot of schools on Ork. And furthermore, did he never go to high school? I thought there was a reference at some point to him going to college. For graduation date, he puts Betty Lou Zombax. And so this is another example of Mork having a date. And I don't know if that's when he graduated from PS1006 or if that's from a later graduation. For residence, he puts Mindy's house. For occupation, he puts observing your primitive planet and reporting back its customs to Orson. There's one question that he can't answer, so Sergei tells him to ask the nice clerk over there. Mork drags the desk by the pen, and Sergei just keeps writing. The clerk rudely asks, now what do you want? Mork says that his friend told him to talk to the nice clerk, but since she's busy, he'll talk to this one. Mork asks, if he can't answer this question, does he fail the exam? The clerk says it's an informational form, and even Mork couldn't fail it. The question turns out to be, have you had a recent vaccination? Mork says, no, but he'd like to go to Miami Beach and stay at the Fontainebleau. The clerk says that a vaccination is when they stick you with a needle. Mork says, oh, I get the point, and he does his bark laugh. The clerk asks Mork where he's from, and Mork says, over there. Mork doesn't have a passport, and he doesn't even know what one is. The clerk asks if Mork has any identification. Mork shows him a mole he has near his knuckle. He figures this is good enough identification because he doesn't think anyone else has one right there. The clerk says this is ridiculous, so Mork says he can show the mole on his right hip. The clerk refuses that. He goes through the list, and Mork has no green card, no passport, no visa, no birth certificate. Mork says he doesn't even have a note from home. The clerk says, legally you don't exist. Mork says, you exaggerate, therefore I am. Kind of Cartesian reasoning there. The clerk calls for the guard and says that there are penalties for being an illegal alien. Mork resents that, because even though his father was an eyedropper, he did marry Mork's mother. And then he adds, he had to. A guard named Bob enters. And then Mindy comes in as the guard grabs Mork's arm. She's going to take him home, but the clerk says they're going to have to detain her friend. She says she got his note, but she didn't understand it. Mork says that he has to register as an alien. She says he doesn't understand, because obviously, as in the pilot, she knows that the consequences would be very severe if they knew the truth about Mork. The clerk quickly explains, and so Mindy has the clerk ask Mork where he's from. He says he's from Ork, which is in the photosphere of the galaxy Mellow Catorius, which is near the black hole Leon. The clerk says he's starting to see. He asks how Mork got here, by boat or plane? Mork says it was a flying egg, so the clerk jokes that he travels by flying bacon himself. Mork says, oh, the express, the sizzler. Mindy has Mork tell the clerk how he drinks. He tells her not to be a clone, but he does say that it's with his finger and he does the little belch thing. The clerk asks the guard to escort Mork out to his flying egg, but first he wants Mork to put the desk back. So Mork uses his finger to move the desk back across the floor. Sergei says that America is a country on the move. Mindy pulls Mork out of the room as he tells her that all of these people are aliens. Sergei goes over to the clerk and says, Nanu, Nanu. The clerk lets out what the captions describe as a whimpering groan. Back at the apartment, Mork and Mindy are preparing a fish, including slicing lemons. Mork wants to know why Sergei called himself an alien if he's never been to the moon. Mindy explains that we call people who came here from other countries aliens. Mork thinks this is strange because everyone on Ork is an Orkin. Humans subdivide into different species. Russians, Americans, Protestants, Jews, game show hosts. And so I've lost track of how many game show host jokes there are, but that's got to be at least the third or fourth this season. Mindy admits that Earthlings haven't learned to live together very well yet. Mork says that after Sergei got his apartment, he went to get his driver's license, and because he was an alien, it took all day. Mindy says that Mork is getting democracy mixed up with bureaucracy. He says semantic confusion or rented lips. Mindy says democracy is the one man, one vote system. Just mention real quickly, this is one of those examples where Mindy is using old-fashioned language that doesn't include women except by implication. She says that bureaucracy is the most difficult way to get anything done, and she jokes that they've had to work real hard to become so bureaucratic. Then more seriously, she says that they are trying to streamline things, but it could take years because of bureaucracy. Sergei drops by, and he's very happy. Because of democracy, he has a place to live and a driver's license. Back home, it would have taken 6 months to get a license. And that if he failed, they would have made him date a female Russian shot putter. Mindy says they're both very happy for him. He gives them a little jar of Russian caviar, and he says he can't stay for dinner because he has to get back and check out his new dynamite pad. In this scene and earlier, we see that he's picked up Mork's habit of saying hello for goodbye. After Sergei leaves, Mork is confused. He says democracy didn't work with three people, or two people, but it works for Sergei, and he lives all alone. Mindy says one of the good things about democracy is it protects the individual. And she says, speaking of protection, next time if Mork has any questions, he should ask Mindy first. Mork calls himself a real Nimnol and says that Mindy told him to take a poll, and he brought home a Russian, and then he laughs at his pun. He's curious about the caviar, and Mindy tells him that it's fish eggs.
Return to mothership. Yeah, back on home. Row, 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 row. How you like it?
No way.
In the tag, Mork is going to be doing his report, and he is doing a Russian song and dance. And there's a pun on Russian, as in rushing. And notably, he calls Orson comrade twice, so I assume this is something he picked up from Sergei, along with the dance. He apologizes to Orson and calls him your rotundity. There's snow inside Mork's mind, and Mork describes it as like Martian lint bombs, only they're frozen, and if you try to light their fuse, they turn to water. He tells Orson a little bit about the custom of voting, so that everyone has a voice in the democracy. Orson asks if everyone votes, and Mork says, no, only about half. The rest have political laryngitis. Orson thinks maybe Earthlings don't like their leaders. Mork says it's too bad they don't have someone as well-rounded as Orson, so Orson asks if that's a fat joke. Mork says, oh no, your obesity. And he says that they can all stand behind Orson. In fact, the entire planet could stand behind him. Orson calls this a cheap shot. Mork does the stage directions thing and says, rejection, heavy thigh, I mean sigh. So a lot of fat jokes here in this episode. In fact, when he signs off, he says, see you next week, your acreage. So I thought this was one of the weaker episodes of season one. Not terrible, but just kind of flat. The thing of Mork finding out about democracy shows potential, but it's attached to this very stereotypical and never that funny to begin with view of Russian immigrants. Ironically, in Moscow on the Hudson, Robin Williams would do a similar character, but with a great deal of more nuance. Tim Thomerson is doing the best he can with the material, I guess, but it's not a very memorable character. It's like Yakov Smirnoff on A Bad Day. The female Russian shot putter joke is not aged well, and it's not super cringy, but I just didn't really get anything out of this character compared to some of the other guest stars. Ned Mortimer does an okay job as the clerk, but again, not super memorable. And, you know, there are some cute moments, some routines with Mork, nothing really classic. I was tempted to go with a 1.5 on this, on the 0 to 4 egg scale, which measures how well this fits what I'm looking for on a Mork and Mindy episode. But I do have to keep in mind that there will be episodes that are much weaker and much further from the basic concept of the show. I mean, this on paper is about Mork learning more about the planet, so I'm going to go with a 2 rather than a 1.5. As for the heart scale, 0 to 4, which measures the viability of a romantic relationship between Mork and Mindy, it didn't feel particularly shippy, unless you want to read something into Mork is hoping to share his bed with Mindy and Sergei. But mostly, he's very innocent in this and not just about sex. It's not a particularly romantic episode. I suppose you could say that Mindy was attracted enough to Mork to invite him to live with her, but she's not attracted to Sergei, but I don't think that's what's going on, because it is different sharing your home with a spaceman compared to a Russian, I guess? I don't know. So I'm again, for the third week in a row, going to give this half a heart. There will definitely be episodes that are less watchable, but I don't feel this is a necessary one. 2 eggs, half a heart. This has been Paula Scheffner with episode 13, Mork and the Immigrant. Nanu, nanu. Do svidaniya.